Hi everyone. Welcome to yet another edition of Let's Talk Design. I'm just going to... Okay, we'll have an issue. I think Firki Studio needs to update their app. So just give me a minute. I'm going to be coordinating this. We'll be joined shortly by them. Give me a second, please. Hope everybody is doing well. We'll be talking about unleashing creativity using stone. We'll be joined by the principal of the very popular Firki Studio, Vasant. One of their principals is joining us. I'm just waiting for him to join us shortly. Thank you all. Thank you all for being so patient. Thank you for because you keep coming back for more. It's really nice to have a fabulous audience like you. If you have any questions for Vasant or for us, on Let's Talk Design, on the power of stone, how it helps in unleashing creativity, please do share your questions in the question box or in the comment section. We'd be happy to respond to the same. Hi. Okay. So I think you are here, Vasant. Okay, Vasant, it says that you need to upgrade your app in order to join. So you will have to upgrade your app using your app store. I don't know what device you're on, but Android or Apple, you'll have to go to the Play Store and upgrade it, update the app. So I'm here waiting while you update, and it should take you just about a minute maybe, and you can come back. Yeah, I cannot accept your request because it's not allowed. Instagram is not allowing me. I think for Instagram Lives, you need to be on their latest version to be able to conduct an Instagram Live. So requesting you to just update it. Thank you. Thanks all for being patient, for joining in. It's nice to see so many of you here. Yes, there. No, I don't have. I can only accept a request to go live from our guest today. I'll have to decline all the other requests that you all are sending me, but thank you. Thank you all. We'll be talking about unleashing the creativity of stone in design. It'll just be a quick 30-minute session. We have a few questions for Vasant. A few requests from people. I will not be able to accept them. Yeah, there we are. Hi.
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 I'm sorry that I wasn't aware of this update thing.
That's fine. I know a lot. I've actually, when I only realized it, I think a couple of months back when I was doing a live with somebody else. That All good. Thank you for being with us here.
Thank you so much. Thank you for having me here and also A-Class Marbles.
Yeah. So I'll straight away jump into this because we have already been a bit late. We try and keep the session to be less than 30 minutes.
Okay.
So I'm going to give you a quick introduction for our audience. So Firki Studio started as an illustration studio called Firki in 2011. It was formed by 2004 in 2014 by Vasant and Sakshi to delve into the field of design and architecture, and was later joined by Shiv as design head and partner. A young team of thinkers focusing on creating designs and memories that are everlasting. Firki Studio is on a journey to understand and explore the term modern Indian aesthetic. While the studio tends to draw inspiration from simplistic observations and day-to-day objects and events, every project is a result of complex collaborative processes, not necessarily bound by a predetermined style. Some of the recent works to rely on are modular methods of execution to develop complex forms from simple methods using local craftsmen. Vasant completed his bachelor's in architecture from SPA Delhi and is a principal architect at Firki Studio. He's an architect and artist who has handled different scales of work from products, furniture, interiors, residential, institutional, to large IT parks. He looks at his practice as an open platform to bring about the balance of art, design, and architecture to build highly customized environments. Thank you, Vasant. It's a pleasure to be speaking to you. You know, I'll just quickly talk about the theme today. Our theme is unleashing the power of creativity using stone. So stone is a material that complements other materials. You know, I'm sure you've also sort of seen that. How does stone fit into your design ideology, the ethos of what Firki does?
I think stone is, I think with mankind, is one of the first materials I think we started exploring. And I think genetically, as a species, I think we are sort of accustomed or used to using this material over the years. And it is a design in itself. It is one of the masterpieces of design by nature. And I think things that are natural, I don't think you really need to struggle in making it work or, you know, complement something. I mean, things like wood and stone, naturally occurring materials, I think they are things that are timeless. So we really don't need to struggle when it comes to design with these kind of materials that age so well. And I think as a practice, we've been trying to explore stone in different forms, and especially looking at using craft as a very important aspect of dealing with this material. Instead of seeing it as a material that would complement something, I think it is a material that complements the entire process of the building industry in itself. It's okay. There in all parts. I mean, it's something that can't be taken away.
Right. So when you are picking up stone for your projects, what are the characteristics that you look for? What are the criteria? Are there special varieties of stone? What is it that you look for?
I think this is something that I learned the hard way over the years, that when I started off the practice, you always used to look at stone as a two-dimensional surface material. Now typically we all start using the material as, but when I realized that selecting the stone is just the beginning of this entire part of, the stone being installed. So it's a partnership between the stone, the people at the quarry, the way it reaches the stone, the distributors, the vendors, and then ultimately it boils down to the craftsman or the mason who is using that stone itself. So why I'm highlighting this aspect is because there are times when you're working in remote parts of the country where you don't have access to very skilled labor, where you're not able to communicate design in the conventional forms of communication, maybe through detailed working drawings. So there are a lot of other constraints that come along with it, and you need to tackle it as a designer holistically. So it depends on how equipped the last person installing that piece or using that piece is. And so let's say if you're working if you're working on a luxury project, or you're working in the metros or some of the tier one cities, it's very easy to get good skills. But when it comes to, let's say, if you're working in some remote or interior parts of central India or maybe in the Northeast, it's then you need to gauge or evaluate who is going to be doing that work. Then you think of how the stone has to be installed. I'll just give an example. We had to install a lot of, a large area of Italian marble or what, these imported stones in one of our projects. But the team who was executing, these are expensive stones, but they're going to be installed by, a team who was never or hardly used, such expensive stones, maybe 400, 500 plus stones, rupees per, square foot stones. So they were probably dealing with Indian marbles or, stones like Jaisalmer and things like that. So for them, the idea that, using such, they were overwhelmed by this aspect itself. So we had to decide, okay, what kind of stone would be the, be then used. Okay, then we took, and we were not able to communicate design through working drawings. So we told them that, okay, you use 3 feet by 3 feet stones. Wherever you get the joints, do a lotus inlay. So we made one sketch and got them to sort of repeat that at every joint rather than measuring each and every piece. So it, so we need to sort of evaluate all the stakeholders that are involved in, I think that's very important in while selecting a stone.
I think that's a very interesting point. I haven't heard that, but it makes a lot of sense, clearly. So you are, you also in your work, like you said, you'd use a lot of modules, right? Your work involves you creating design statements using modules. How do you think you can use stone in this context?
Yeah, I think I don't know. It's either whether it's fortunately or unfortunately, a lot of times most of our projects have been in places where you don't have access to good contractors or good project managers, and you end up either being at site as a supervisor apart from being the designer yourself. So, so we realized it. We realized that like as I just mentioned a while back, that design communication is very important. I was, I mean, some of the first few places where I was trained as an architect after my graduation, we made such beautiful drawings. And it was a, struggle after that. I mean, only architects end up reading those pretty drawings and not the guys at site. And I think the quality of contractors and execution team has just been deteriorating over the years. So what we realized is that a very it was something which evolved over the years, this process of creating a template and trying to repeat it. So all your effort goes in communicating design only for that one module. So let's say you have to create a very interesting flooring pattern that's sort of an inlay or a pattern that is rotating, for example, or repeating in a particular fashion, but looks as a very complicated, intricate pattern when you see it holistically. So if you break these down into smaller textures or patterns and then train them to only create that. So you specifically train or make many prototypes or samples and get them to create these few modules. And then it lies in your creativity as to how you want to use that module. So then design communication becomes very easy. Then, I mean, you train one mason, then all the other 10 masons who are working at that site just have to copy that. And we are very good at copying. So I think so that works best. And this we've tried with not just stone, I mean, all kinds of materials, be it metal, be it brick, be it, I mean, even glass for that matter. I mean, we've used all kinds of materials, but this modular method works. And also, the other aspect, the beautiful aspect of this is that when you're working with a module, you're also able to give flexibility to the craftsman who's working with it. Let's say you've fixed a particular module which you're trying to repeat. It does not necessarily have to be a copying. Repetition could be a parameter that you're fixing. It could be a rotation, it could be a tilt, it could be anything. But within that one module, if the craftsman is able to work around and create design or give him flexibility within that, like how it used to be done in traditional temples. I mean, you had the overall impression of the temple, but every sculptor had his own space within which he could create his own story. So we've even tried that. So we once created this huge wall that was almost 30 feet. It was a wall cladding, So we gave them triangular pieces. So we told them that, you know, to minimize the wastage, we gave them triangular pieces. I think they were 6 inch, 1 feet, and 2 feet. And then we left the craftsmen to create a collage out of that. So it was amazing to see that process. I mean, they were creative. I mean, you really underestimate the creativity of the craftsman or the mason who's working at site. So it was almost like we just gave them the medium. Stone was the medium, and they had the entire canvas to play with. And we learned a lot in that whole process. So I really like this way of working.
Okay, so you know, apart from walls and flooring, right, which are the more traditional sort of ways in which stone is used, what are the ways in which you have explored stone? I mean, we know that you do work with product design and you do a lot of other sort of dynamic sort of installations, and where do you think you have managed to sort of unleash this power of stone?
I think we are working, or I think we are right now. It's an interesting place where we are working right now. We are trying to use stone as a ceiling surface, and we are trying to push that. Again, it's a modular method of working. It's more like a three-dimensional curve that we are trying to generate. But by by using very, what is it, idiot-proof joinery details, I would say we are trying to work out stone being used as a ceiling. It's not very commonly used. It's an extension of a wall that sort of turns out into the ceiling. So we are trying to explore that. And the second thing is that something which I personally feel is I'm looking forward, and I'm sure A Class Marbles would be having a solution to this. Is I'm looking forward to using stone as thin as it can be. I mean, over the years, I mean, the thickness of stone has been reducing. What you used to, give a spec of 20 mm, reduced to 18 mm, then 16 mm, and it's getting thinner. And a lot of architects have been complaining about this, but on the hindsight, I am really looking forward to this. I'm looking forward to the day when we can get stone slices of 4 to 5 mm thick, which are Then are you there? Have I got disconnected?
Yeah, I'm there. Can you hear
Yeah.
me?
So I am looking forward to using this as paper thin thin veneers of stone, of natural stone, and this is an experiment that again we are trying with but slices. But right now it's an experiment we are trying with Indian stones of using thin slices of flakes. But if it is possible to access paper-thin stones, I think there'll be nothing like it.
So, do you have, I mean, of course, for vertical surfaces and horizontal surfaces, do you have any tips or, you know, what should our audience sort of consider? What are the factors that the audience should consider when they are using stone for different surfaces? Like, what are the things to keep in mind when you're designing for horizontal surfaces versus vertical surfaces?
Are you asking in the context of, I mean, the interior surfaces or exterior
Interior surfaces.
interior surfaces? I think the beauty of stone lies in, I mean, in the way we see the stone itself. I think for which you need light, and could be artificial or natural light. So, for example, in a courtyard. So, you've got a courtyard in a space, and I think the Indian context, the sun is more up than in the European context, where, I mean, in Europe you rely a lot on the shadow pattern falling on the walls, whereas we rely a lot on the shadow pattern falling on the ground. So I think so the way you reflect, or the colors that you choose that reflect light, is very important. And a lot of people do believe that, yes, using light colors, white, the Vietnam, the Thanos, they are very popularly used where you want to make the space look big and very reflective. I sort of differ in opinion there, and I prefer to use darker stones. I know it's a personal choice, I guess, but I prefer to use darker stones that also reflect very well. It's It's like comparing or expecting reflection on a white automobile versus a black automobile. So both do reflect, but they are, both have their own charm. I mean, a well-polished black car or that comes just, you know, just out of the showroom looks beautiful, and
I
the same
think
new car is.
also, we've had actually a lot of people who've come here on this series, and a lot of people are actually a lot of designers have spoken about their preference for dark stones, and it's probably a myth that dark stones make the space look smaller and all of that. So I think it's a
It's
question that
yes,
comes up very often as well.
yes. I mean, it's very tough to convince your clients because they come from a conventional thought that, you know, white is a white light beige. I mean, it's beige is what everyone wants, and we're like, come on, there's so much more than the beige. Yeah, and I think vertical surfaces are absolutely underrated. I mean, people don't use stone as much as they would do it on the horizontal surfaces. I mean, the percentage of stone being used. I would always love to use stone more on the vertical surfaces than on the horizontal surfaces. I mean, for example, if it's a residence in a house, barring the common areas, I mean, you look at rooms, maybe a study or a bedroom, a lot of area gets covered in the bed itself, the carpets, a lot of other furniture, loose furniture that's lying around, and what you really see are the walls and the ceiling. And I would wish to use them and use maybe use relief work with stone. Maybe it could be three-dimensional. You could play with textures and use them on these surfaces. And as a designer, I think you can always enhance the existing grain that is already there. And the last point is the color, the choice of color. I mean, if you are a person, I mean, as a firm, we really like to use bright, bold colors and very pop in the way we try to, you know, work. So I love like the Saint Lawrence, for example. I mean, the black, the dark stone with a streak of yellow or white, or even the Marquinhos, for example. And then you could complement them with yellow walls. The yellow walls could be with the travertines or even the Jaisalmers, even Indian stones. There's no harm in, you know, mixing them up with. So, I mean, we've done a bedroom where you've got Nero's, I mean, the Saint Lawrence on the floor and the bed back done in Jaisalmer. So, and it's come out well.
Well, thank you for sharing these references and examples, because that's what sort of makes it clearer in anybody's mind. So you are my last question to you is, you're known for designing for a budget, right? And that's something that's a concern for almost every client, no matter how much their budget is. When it comes to good stone, what are the stones that you would recommend, keeping the budget in mind?
I think often it's very difficult to name a stone. I mean, because selection of stone, it's yes, budget is very important.
Yeah, let me make it easier. Maybe you can give us a few references for residential projects and for commercial projects. You know, what are the stones that work well in residential projects, and what are the stones that work well in commercial projects?
I mean, I would before picking a stone, I would rather put it in a way where one really needs to understand the decor and the budget and, you know, sort of balance both of them. And the budget does not necessarily have to be seen as square footage cost of stone. So I see while picking a stone, I mean, a lot of times we end up picking stones that are 1,000, 1,500 plus. But it is about how meticulously you use these stones and where you use these stones. So if while designing a space, if you've identified your highlights right in the beginning, and you know that these are the accents, these are the spaces where, or these are large surfaces, and I would prefer to use stone where you have ample amount of space to sort of appreciate the grains or the texture that it is naturally found on the stone. So, and also it should have a good viewing distance to appreciate that. I mean, so based on these parameters, I would prefer to, you know, sort of pick a stone and minimize its use. Minimize its use. So budget. So that's how we always been playing around with the budget as to. A lot of times we deliver even lesser than the budget that's been you know, allocated to us just by sheer, you know, thoughtfulness in the way you are designing. Clients just, they just calculate square footage. They've got a house of, let's say, 7,000-8,000 square feet. They decide that, they just calculate it. They just multiply that with 500 rupees a square foot as an average, let's say. So, but I don't think that's how you allocate a budget. So we would rather go room wise or space wise, give identify highlights, and that's primarily it. And then and also it depends on the usage of the stone where you're trying to apply them. The selection of the stone. So if it's going to be a washroom, you would be looking for more harder stones, non-porous, or otherwise you will have to treat them accordingly. It is okay to use porous surfaces in places that are where you've got a good amount of light falling over it and it's not going to get wet. Whereas my favorites, if I had to pick stones, my favorites are the Marquinas and the Saint Lawrence, which I always keep recommending to a lot of people, and even the Williams, the Grey Williams. These are some of the my personal favorites. I generally stay away from the beiges and browns because that generally does not go with the aesthetics that we prefer.
Right.
As a practice, because there's a lot of vibrant colors that are always introduced, and these colors sort of gel well with all tones. So,
Sure. Okay, great. Thank you so much, Vasant. This is very insightful, and I mean, it's very interesting to hear your, take on some of these questions that get asked very often, actually, on the session. Last but not the least, we follow the hashtag Let's Talk Design. That's the series, that's what the series is called. So if you had to sum up one thing on stone when it comes to Let's Talk Design, what would that be?
Okay, it's not. I don't think it could be one thing, but I think the very first thing that comes to mind is I think for any architect or a designer, I think in a span of 30, 40 odd years that you would be working, you would be picking and playing with stone so often. But in this 30, 40 years, you're dealing with material that's millions of years old. So I think the very first thing is I think you need to give a huge amount of respect to the material that you're going to be is your canvas or where you're going to be playing with. So two, three things which I am actually looking forward from the industry is that given that stone, the whole process itself is an unsustainable one. The whole process of querying and using, sometimes a lot of times, it doesn't make sense. But it's also that we don't have an alternative. We don't have a good alternative to a stone. Which has all its characteristics. So, assuming that we are a part of this unsustainable process, the least we could do as designers is to make the remaining half of the journey of the stone a memorable one for it by making it a little more sustainable by probably at least promoting local skill, craft, traditional methods. Trying to revive some of the traditional joineries and methods that were being used. That's a little bit of contribution that you could do while using stone. And I think apart from some parts of India, especially Rajasthan, I think it's dying. The whole skill is dying, and especially in South India, I think it's reducing a lot. So I think I'm yet to see that. And the last thing which I would expect, and I think a lot of, I think I'm sure A-class marbles would come up with, I think another, come up with solutions to things like this is, what I've been observing is that some of, even when it, I mean, the one, I was just talking about introducing craft, but yes, a lot of people are working with technology also with stone. So you've got water jets and you've got multi-axis milling, all kinds of methods to either do inlays or carvings and use stone blocks or even stone slabs. But all these are subtractive processes. You're probably carving out, there's a lot of wastage, there's a lot of powder that is getting it's just blown away. And I'm looking forward to, now with I think 3D printing or any other additive format, if there could be a better additive format where you're able to use powdered stone in a much better way. I mean, traditionally people were using the terrazzos or the mosaics as an additive method, but I'm looking forward to a high-tech method for an additive process. And I think let's not waste stone. And my only advice to all would be, which we have been trying hard, is wherever you're using stone, if be it a jali, try to use patterns that where after it's cut, those patterns or the negatives that are left out can be used somewhere else in the project. That's about it.
That's a fabulous note to end this conversation on. Thank you so much, Vasant. You know, as a gesture, A-Class is celebrating 50 years of being in the industry this year. And as a gesture to everybody who's, been a part of this journey, they'll be planting a tree on your behalf and they'll be sending you a certificate.
Oh, that's wonderful.
Yeah, so on your note, yeah, I think A-Class is definitely working on it. So thank you very much for your ideas and for all the inspiration. Let's keep talking this.
Yes, absolutely. Thank you. And I think best wishes to A-Class Marvel also to, I think, take this whole industry forward in the right direction. And thank you so much, Tanya, for having me. Yeah.
Thank you. Thanks. It's a nice speaking to you. Thank you.